evening. I'm Nadia Sheikh. I'm the Vice Provost for Cultural and Research Engagement here at the NYU Abu Dhabi. I welcome you to the Institute and to attend the talk by Dr. Letizia, Osti, which is entitled The Abbasid Caliph and His People, A View from the Center. Letizia Osti obtained her PhD from the University of St. Andrews, and she is currently Associate Professor of Arabic Language and Literature at the University of Milan. She has published on classical Arabic prose and narrative techniques in biographical collections, historiography, literature, and intersections. Her most recent publications include a monograph with the title History and Memory in the Abbasid Caliphate, Writing the Past in Medieval Arabic Literature. This is a wonderful book that explores the life, times, and works of the scholar polymath Abu Bakr Suli, a favorite of ours. She is currently working on the socio-cultural aspects of Dharf in Abbasid Iraq. She has edited a number of volumes pertaining to Abbasid history, and Dr. Osti is currently working on a volume on space and movement in classical Arabic prose. In this lecture, Letizia discusses the different ways in which historical and literary sources for the mid-10th century describe the role and influence of the Abbasid Caliph and the Abbasid capital, Baghdad, at a time of profound political and cultural change. Thank you, Letizia, for being with us. The floor is yours.
My presentation has disappeared. I don't know what to do. Now it's back. Good evening, everybody. First of all, thank you very much, Nadia, and thank you, NYU, for the wonderful hospitality, for the wonderful welcome you gave me. It's really, and I always say that friendship in our profession goes through the head first, but it really reaches the heart, and this is one of these occasions. So I'm going to start with a passage by the 10th century Iraqi historian Al-Masudi. And this is a remark that he makes when discussing the siege of Baghdad in 812. During the civil war between Al-Amin and Al-Ma'mun, the two sons of Harun al-Rashid. He says, the war continued between the supporters of Al-Ma'mun and those of Al-Amin for 14 months. The population of Baghdad did not know where to take refuge. The mosques were deserted, the prayers no longer said. No such disaster had occurred there since Al-Mansur founded the city. Later, at the time of the wars between Al-Musta'in and Al-Mu'taz, the inhabitants had again to suffer something similar. The vagabonds of the city went again into battle using men as horses. No war was more disastrous for Baghdad, however, than that between Al-Ma'mun and his deposed brother Al-Amin. And here I put the Arabic in this presentation because I know not everybody does read Arabic, but I want to highlight this word, Daqat. The translation said the people of Baghdad didn't know where to take refuge. What it says is Daqat. Baghdad bi ahliha. Baghdad became too narrow, that pressed his inhabitants in, and they didn't know where to go. It's a verb that really makes you claustrophobic. You don't know where to go. There's nobody to nowhere to take refuge. And the other thing that I wanted to I'll go like this. It's safer. Okay, so this is the first thing. And the other thing is this khuruj. خروج العيارين is خرج, to go out in battle, usually. So keep in mind these two words. Then he goes on, and he talks about his own day. And he says, nowadays, the year 943, the inhabitants of Baghdad give great importance to what they suffered when the Caliph al-Muttaqi left them. And before this, the misfortunes that befell them at the hand of the Baridis, Ibn Ra'iq, and Tuzun the Turk. They consider a calamity the rebellion of Nasir al-Dawla and his brother, Saif al-Dawla. Now, I put the Arabic here as well to show you again this word khuruj, to go out. But in this case, is the khuruj al-bihaq al-muttaqi billah anhum. The caliph al-muttaqi goes out from them, he leaves them, he abandons them. And then we have another khuruj, khuruj of all these people, alayhim. So these people, these generals who revolt, who go against the citizens in battle. So to me, those of you who read Arabic, I think it may be interesting to note these two uses of the word. So let's have a quick look at who I'm talking about. So we have, this is Harun al-Rashid here. This is the foundation of the city by the second caliph, Abbasid Caliph al-Mansur, up here. Then we have Harun al-Rashid, the famous caliph, we don't need to introduce him. His two sons, Al-Amin and Al-Ma'mun, these are the two involved in the first siege of Baghdad. The second siege is down here, Al-Musta'ayna, who is and Al-Mu'taz is his rival. Okay, and Al-Mas'ud this time is here. This is Al-Mu'taz, down here. I'll tell you more just in a moment. But what I wanted to highlight in this passage is really a ranking of disasters, a ranking of crises for the population of Baghdad. What's the worst of the worst for the population up to al-Mas'udi's own time? So the first one is probably the best known. The first siege of Baghdad is the final phase of the war between al-Amin, the son and successor of Harun al-Rashid, and his brother al-Ma'mun. The trauma of this conflict largely explains the subsequent crystallization of the long reign of Harun as the golden age. Always think it with, in quotes, of the Abbasid Caliphate. Harun is the paradigm of the caliph, immortalized in the collective memory, together with his own Baghdad, in the 1001 night. However, the tumultuous years that follow his death are linked to a specific choice by al-Rashid. In an attempt to avoid the war of succession, he publicly established that after his death, the caliphate would pass to his eldest son, al-Amin. But that during the reign of the latter, his likely younger second son, al-Ma'mun, would assume control of Khorasan. On Harun's death in 809, al-Amin did become caliph, and al-Ma'mun did move to Mer, to Khorasan. But there was no agreement on how and to what extent Khorasan should be independent from the capital, especially financially. After 2 years of negotiations in 811, the military conflict started, and a few months later, Baghdad was put to siege, and the siege lasted over a year, and it ended with the deposition and death of al-Amin. The passage we've just seen by al-Mas'udi refers to the month of the siege, when Al-Amin, abandoned by the majority of the army, resorted to the civilian population, the Ayaron. It's debatable how we translate this term, the vagabonds. Some historians see this episode as a real popular uprising, perhaps the closest thing to a revolution that the first centuries of Islamic history have seen. So the second event, the event that Al-Masudi compares with the first, is also a siege, and it takes place about half a century after Al-Ma'mun's victory over Al-Amin. And this is the so-called Samarra period, when the caliph has his capital, his court, reside in Samarra in the second part of the 9th century. Also in this case, it is a conflict between the ruler and an usurper. The caliph al-Musta'in, strongly opposed by some power groups, does not feel safe in Samarra and, accompanied by his supporters, leaves the city and heads to Baghdad. The troops left in Samarra choose a new caliph, his cousin al-Mu'taz, and put Baghdad under siege. And the second siege lasts a little less than the first one, a little less than a year. And again, the caliph, gradually abandoned by his troops, rely on the civilian population like Al-Amin. And the conclusion is also very similar. While Al-Amin was killed in Baghdad, Al-Musta'in agreed to abdicate and retreat to Medina, but he was arrested and killed before he could reach Medina. Now, the third event. The third event, the one in Masudi's time, and it says nowadays, it's not although Al-Masudi downplays it a little bit, the issues he alludes to will prove crucial to the fate of the city and of the Abbasids in general. The events are part of a decade of unrest, which will mark, in the interpretation of many historians, including modern ones, the definitive end of the Abbasid Caliphate as a political power. The first symbolically significant step in this decade is in 936, the appointment of a certain Ibn Ra'iq as Amir al-Umara, chief general, general-in-chief, which means that the caliph effectively hands this general not only the military authority, and in fact the caliph is now almost no longer able to pay an army under its direct control, but also the civil administration. The Amir al-Umara is responsible for collecting taxes from those provinces that still proclaim themselves faithful to the caliph. In the following years, many military leaders will compete for the title of Amir al-Umara, some repeatedly, some for very short times. A certain degree of stability would return only 10 years later, in 946, with the appointment of Ahmad ibn Buya as Amir al-Umara and the beginning of the so-called Buyid century. So the names that al-Masudi mentions in the passage as rebels are those of the various generals who compete for the title and for the power over this decade. These generals recognize the power of the caliph less and less, only nominally. It is they who select him from among the members of the Abbasid family, and they replace him when he tries to escape their control. And in this context, the victim is often the population of Baghdad. The caliph is no longer able to protect the population. And by the time al-Masudi is writing, the caliph al-Muttaqi has left the capital for the second time, leaving the city in the hands of competing military commanders and their troops. He will only return the following year blinded and deposed, or deposed and blinded. Most historiographical accounts compiled since the late 10th century describe this period as really a gradual descent into chaos, and they identify it as the beginning of an era of decline for the caliphate, not only politically and economically, but also regarding administrative practices and also regarding culture, cultural production. Al-Masudi, however, speaks as a contemporary. He's living these things. And on the one hand, as a historian, he underlines the importance of a comparative and long-term vision. And on the other, in his present of 1943, he implies a certain optimism that the city's current crisis may be just one of many and will soon be overcome. It should also be noted that Al-Masudi's passage implies that the caliph's removal from the capital is at least a sign, if not a cause, of crisis in the eyes of his population. This differs from tradition and from classical doctrine, which indicates amongst the main tasks of the caliph that of leading the pilgrimage to Mecca and leading the army in the defense of the territories of Islam. However, when Al-Masudi arrives, the caliph has no longer performed these duties personally. On the contrary, leaving the capital means losing control of it completely, abandoning the population to the oppression of the general in charge. In other words, in the first two cases, it is a siege. The caliph is pressed in the city, cannot get out and flee. And in the third case, the caliph is pulled out of the city and should not go out of the city. So, but let's go back where a caliph should be in space. Al-Masudi himself, elsewhere, quotes a quote, by the way, the people who were here 2 days ago, this is the same passage, the same page in Al-Masudi where he talks about Zubaydah. He also talks about Harun al-Rashid, who was the husband of Zubaydah, and he says that Harun al-Rashid was scrupulous in fulfilling his duties as a pilgrim in the Hajj and in waging war. He undertook public works, he scattered wealth and the treasure of his justice on all his subjects, he strengthened the frontiers, he carried out works of military architecture. He built caravanserais and rebats, and his officials, that's very important, his officials followed his example, and the people imitated his behavior, and then he goes on, error was repressed, the truth reappeared, etc., etc. Note also, this will come useful later, he was the first among the Abbasid caliphs to play chess and backgammon. And such was the splendor, wealth, and prosperity of his reign that they called this period the days of the marriage feast. So, to summarize, the paradigmatic caliph in the Golden Age may be based in the city or not. Harun actually spent most of his time in Dhaka, but is present everywhere. He goes on the Hajj. He leads the army, he takes care of public works. However, by the 10th century, it is not conquest that drives the caliph. On the contrary, it is a fight for survival. Nor does the caliph lead his own army. On the contrary, he follows the commander who has momentarily undertaken to protect him. Therefore, he has not only lost his authority, he has lost the ability to negotiate authority. Now, let's go back for a moment to our Abbasid family tree and see what I'm going to concentrate for the rest of this lecture. So we've seen this is Harun al-Rashid. Here is the first siege of Baghdad. Here is the second siege of Baghdad. Here is al-Muttaqi. So we are here. This is al-Muqtadir. At the beginning of the 10th century, who is succeeded briefly by his brother, and then there are his two sons, Al-Radi and Al-Muttaqi, in succession. So these are the four, this is the period. Al-Muqtadir is the one with the longest reign, and I'm only going to speak briefly about him. The other three, well, Qahir will not talk about Qahir. Nobody talks about Qahir. He only reigned for 3 years. He was obviously mad. He hasn't left much in terms of imprint in the culture, apart from being very, very mad. So, I don't know how to say that in English. Anyway, so these are the two brothers who ruled one after the other that we are going to talk about a little bit longer. But let's talk about Al-Muqtadir a little bit. I know there are several partisans of Al-Muqtadir in this room. He reigned, he's famous for a few things. The first thing is that he was appointed very young. He was the youngest caliph at that point, at 13. He reigned for comparatively long. He was very private. He rarely came out of... he only came out of Baghdad, went out of Baghdad on the last day of his life, because he was killed as soon as he went out. His caliphate is known as the beginning of the end for the political power of the Abbasids. And whose fault is it? It's the women's fault, of course, because he obeyed his mother too much. But let's not talk about this. Let's talk about the manner of Al-Muqtadir's death. Al-Muqtadir is facing the rebellion of one of his generals. So he is convinced, he is told by his vizier, please go out and meet the troops, and when they see you, they will bow down to you, because they will recognize you as the true caliph, the true leader. And things do not go exactly as planned. This first arib depicts the way the caliph goes out. He wore a caftan of silver brocade from Tusra. On his head was a plain black turban, and the mantle that had belonged to the prophet was on his shoulders, covering his chest and his back. He was girded with Dhul-Fiqar, the sword of the apostle, with its red leather straps. In his right hand was the seal and the staff of the prophet. Under him was the horse called Al-Iqbal. On the horse there was a red Maghribi saddle with new decoration, and under his left thigh was the sword of the Sirup. In front of him rode his son, Abu Ahmad, wearing an embroidered caftan of Byzantine brocade and a white turban, while behind him rode his vizier, Al-Fadla ibn Ja'far ibn Al-Furat. In front of them went a white banner and a black flag, and another banner carried by Ahmad ibn Khafif al-Samarqandi. There were also two white standards and two yellow ones carried by the Ansar, who also carried spears with leaves of the Quran on their points. Just imagine what it was like. Caliph sets out. It doesn't go as planned. This is the second source that gives us how it ends. Just then, the Berber followers of Mu'anis, who was the rebel general, came up and surrounded Al-Muqtadir. One of them struck him from behind, a blow that brought him to the ground. He cried out, "Curse you, I'm the caliph." The Berber said, "If you are master." He made the caliph lie on the ground and cut his throat with a sword. The head of Al-Muqtadir was raised upon a sword, then upon a stake. He was stripped of his clothing, even his underwear, and left stark naked to the laboring man who passed by, covered him with hay, and dug a grave for him where he lay, buried him, and obliterated the traces. Now, I will not say anything more about Al-Muqtadir, but I will say that if you want to know more about him, there is this book published a few years ago, which we wrote together with two of my esteemed colleagues here and another one who's absent. And if you're curious about Al-Muqtadir, please. But now, I want to talk about Al-Muqtadir's son, Al-Radin, who's a very interesting character, because he actually goes out. So Al-Muqtadir only goes out on the last day of his life. Al-Radi goes on two journeys. Al-Radi is a completely different person. He reigns for a much shorter time, just for 6-7 years. He's famous. His father was famous for being ignorant. He's famous for being a scholar, a very literary person. He wrote poetry. He read. He had always a lot of cultured people around him. He had receptions. He's also the one who appointed the first Amir al-Umara, the first general-in-chief. So he was the first one who surrendered de facto political power to somebody else. He said, I cannot deal. These deals cannot deal. And actually, he had five viziers in the space of 6 years. There were five viziers. That's a lot in comparison with previous years. There were two Amir al-Umara. The first one didn't last very long. He also had two teams of boon companions who he received regularly. We'll see this later. And he went on two journeys, both of them following his Amir al-Umara. And we'll see why. His brother, who reigned after him, he reigned for even less. He was deposed and blinded by his own Amir al-Umara, who decided that he was more troubled than he was worth. He wanted no courtiers. He dismissed all the courtiers. He said, my boon companion, my jalis, is going to be the Quran. I don't want anybody else. But during his only 4 years of caliphate, he had 10 viziers and 5 Amir al-Umara. It was very unstable. Not only he couldn't control anything, but nobody could control anything. Now, we have a contemporary source on this, and this is the source I've been working on for the past many years. So before I talk to you about the material, I want to talk about the man, because in the case of Osti, it is very difficult to separate the man from the man from his work, also for a lot of modern scholars. So this is a fairly an early biography of Osti. Who is he? A literateur, an adib, a zarif, a refined man, a collector of books. He was the table companion of al-Radi, having at first been his teacher, and also had been the companion of al-Muqtafi and then al-Muqtadir without a break. His life is too well known for us to be necessary to treat it in great detail. He was one of the best of his time at chess and a man of value. And then he gives us this book. Okay, so maybe he was a courtier. Let's see another early, slightly later biographer. He was a well-established table companion of the caliphs, having served al-Muqtafi, then al-Radi, then al-Muqtadir. He was also unequaled in his time in the game of chess, to the point that it was said that he was the one who invented it. He had a library which he had devoted to the different books he had collected. He had organized them very well in it. And then a list of his books, of the books he wrote. So was he a chess player? There's another later biography. And I'm sure that some of you know this story. I met many people who believe that this Osti is the inventor of chess, but this is wrong. It was the Indian Sutta Dahir who invented chess for a king called Shehram. The king said to Sutta, request what you wish. And Sista answered a request that you put a grain of wheat on the first square and then continue doubling its number up to the last square. Whatever amount it reaches, you give it to me. I am sure that several people in this room will know this story and will know how it ends. Well, do you think the king had enough wheat? What do you think? Let's take a poll. I think it's pretty safe to say that the king did not have enough wheat. Otherwise, the story wouldn't work. Wait, but the biographers also said that he was a book collector. Let's see what another biography says. He had a house full of books which he had arranged in rows. The covers were of different colors. He would say all of these books have been checked and corrected by a teacher. When he needed to consult one of them, he would say, boy, bring me such and such book. And of course, not everybody, of course, this is another common thing that we say, that oral transmission is so much more important than written transmission. The written word was not trusted very much. So there is this, this is a short invective poem. What a sheikh is a fool indeed, library-wise, he's the best there is. When you ask him a question, seeking from him an explanation, he says, quick, boys, bring of science such and such ring. I'm going to try to recite it in Arabic, so please bear with me. إِنَّمَا فُولِيُ شَيْخٌ عَلَمُ النَّاسِ خِزَانَ إِنْ سَأَلْنَاهُ بِعِلْمٍ طَلَبًا مِنْهُ إِبَانَ قَالَ يَغَلْمَانُ هَاتُ رِزْمَةَ الْعِلْمِ كُلَانَ. And I apologize. Come on. So, Asuli is all of these things, but the thing is, he is a scholar, and because he's all of his of these colorful things, we tend to forget that he is a very good scholar, and he is the very, very well placed as a witness to this period that is so difficult to understand, because there are so many people going up and down the Tigris, really fighting for each single village, each single town. Actually, this is a timeline in of his life. I'm not going to go very in very much in detail, but you see that this is the caliph. He lived through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 caliphs, of which he was, there are news of him at the court of Al-Muqtadi, of Mu'tadid, Muqtafi, he was certainly at court, Al-Muqtadi, he was at court, Al-Qahir was mad, we don't know, Al-Radi, he was at court, and Al-Muttaqi, he was thrown out, not very politely, and then went to live in, Basra. He had access at court, for many years in Basra, he retired, and then he worked a little bit, moved around, trying to find employment by with these Amir al-Umara, who also wanted to keep a court. But the problem is, you know, they were here one day, there another day. They died very quickly, so he then retired to Basra, and we have news of him teaching in Basra, and we have stories about him there as well. He died in mysterious circumstances. It's that they say that everybody was out to look looking for him because they wanted to kill him, but we don't know why. This is the book that Nadia was talking about, History and Memory in the Abbasid Caliphate. The title is very grand, but it's really about Asuli and how great of a scholar he was, in my opinion. So, I still haven't told you much about his work. His work, he writes on a lot of things. He writes on chancery, he writes on chess. He writes on poetry a lot. He's a very, for example, he's the one who edits the Diwan of Abu Nawas, famous poet Abu Nawas. Or he writes chronicles, but somehow the chronicles are not appreciated very much. They say, well, he likes gossip. He doesn't see events in their own greater context. He is too vain. There is too much poetry in his work. He's only interested in the petty squabbles between the courtiers at court. So he's a good eyewitness, but he's not a good interpreter of events. Now, I'm going to give you an example of the sort of the sort of information that's looked down upon by historians, mainly, even modern historians. Here's a story about something happening at court. After the caliph's return from Mosul, we court companions resumed the usual shifts, two groups of four, each 2 days per week. And she's just sitting at the caliph's table, keeping the caliph company. The Banu al-Munajjim, however, did not receive gifts. Ahmad ibn Yahya al-Munajjim, one of the rival team, came not only when it was his turn and he didn't get gifts, but also when it was our turn. Usually, he was rejected, but sometimes Al-Radi did not have the heart to deny him access, and he joined our group at the table. One day, he said, I would like to serve your lordship every day without regular shifts, except Wednesdays and Fridays. From then on, he began to show up every day, and the caliph asked us to do likewise, so to go every day. We explained to him that no such thing had ever happened and that our bodies couldn't handle it. We also warned Ahmad to not establish a custom that would be harmful to all of us. But he didn't want to give up, fearing that he would no longer receive gifts if this arrangement changed. Because, of course, the Jalis, the boon companion, had a salary, a fixed salary, but a lot of what he earned was also every time he went to court, he would get a present from the palace, most of the time. Thus, we would go to Al-Radi and stay until dawn. Then we would leave, and when we returned, the caliph resumed the banquet. As in these occasions he urged us to eat and drink, we had frequent complaints of digestion, and we were not always able to attend. This regime worsened the health of the caliph. God gave us some respite during Ramadan, but when Shawwal arrived, we returned to the same system. We all got sick, including me, for many days. After a long illness, which he had deserved, Ahmad died, may God rest his soul, the following month. Now, this may well seem gossip, useful. It's useful for the practical details it reveals. Of course, there's a lot of story here. There's a lot of practical things about how the court works, but not for any insight on the part of a story. However, what is missed is often the remark at the top. After the caliph came back from Mosul, this alludes to the second journey of Al-Radi, which lasted 2 months. We said that he went on 2 journeys. Al-Radi, and now I will tell you a little bit about this. This journey. He sets out towards Mosul because where Ibn Hamdan, who's one of these generals and who will then become Nasr al-Dawla, had been withholding the revenue, the taxes that he was supposed to send the caliph. The journey, the caliph organized the journey with Bashkam, who is by this point has replaced Amir al-Umara and is now himself Amir al-Umara. And the Suli says that despite the advice to the contrary from many parties, Al-Radi established that it is absolutely necessary to leave, and it is suggested to him that he put his chamberlain at the head of troops independent from those of the Amir al-Umara, and that he keep track of the numbers of soldiers that of this Amir. But he follows the first suggestion, but ignores the second. He ignores the suggestion to keep in check his Amir al-Umara Bashkam and not let his army become too big. Now, disregarding this advice, says Asuli, is one of the faults Al-Radi had been blamed for. And he also mentions that the population of Baghdad is not happy about the caliph leaving to confront Ibn Hamdun. Ibn Hamdan has been generous to the poor of the city in the past, to the poor of Baghdad, sending flour and money in periods of famine. And moreover, his brother Ali, the future Saif al-Dawla, has been active on the Byzantine frontier, leading the traditional summer campaign, the Saifa, and other conquests. And in other words, to remember what we were saying before about Harun al-Rashid, the two brothers have been carrying out the traditional duties of the caliph. Now, by the time the caliph's party, which includes also the caliph travels with his coaches, with Suli included, by the time they reach Samarra, there's already news of unrest in Baghdad. While from Mosul, Ibn Hamdan, having heard of the expedition, begins to send messages offering conditions which Rasuli considers better than expected. So the consensus, says Rasuli, amongst the courtiers, is that the caliph should stay in Samarra, let Bashkam, the Amir al-Umara, go to Mosul, and join him only if strictly necessary. And in fact, after a few days in Samarra, the courtiers take it in turn to try to persuade the caliph to go back to Baghdad. This is Baghdad. Here is Samarra. Samarra is on the east side. Here the it's written on the west, but the dot is on the east. And here is Mosul, up here. So they're in Samarra, and they say, go back. So they take it in turn. Here is what Suli says. Commander of the faithful, the loyal servant, does not conceal from his master anything that is in his heart, nor does he store away his advice to him. Likewise, there is nothing wrong for the master in hearing out his servant's words. If he is right, the caliph will approve, and if he is wrong, he will do as if he had not heard him. The caliph laughs. Tell me what you have. So he goes on to say exactly what we were saying before. Ibn Hamdan is acting, he's performing the duties of the armies of Islam. He is defending Islam, and he's helping the poor of Baghdad, the poor of the city, and the army you are marching with is doing none of this. They are hired arms. They don't deserve you. They don't deserve to be your army. So he goes, you would do well to accept his proposition and go back to the capital to dispel the fear of revolt on the part of Ibn Ra'iq, because Ibn Ra'iq is left in Baghdad and is not treating the population very well. These and other arguments are futile, as the next day, the caliph says, oh, yes, that's very interesting, I think about it, and the next day, they leave for Mosul. For a few days, they stop in Tikrit, where the cycle is repeated. There are news of Ibn Ra'iq, the former Amir, gathering troops and followers in Baghdad. The caliph responds to Asuli. It's significant. He says, Asuli says, so he's in the room with the caliph, and the chamberlain makes a sign, and he goes, Commander of the faithful, Baghdad is the seat of the government, the home of the caliphate. There is no going back if you abandon it. And the caliph goes, it used to be so, when the treasury had millions of dinar at the time of Al-Muqtadid and twice as much at the time of Al-Muqtadid. Now that the treasury is empty, it is like any other place. In other words, not only does the caliph need to move out of Baghdad in order to reach out, to go and get hold of the revenue that he needs to survive, he does not consider the city worth fighting for, as it is no longer the center of power. But there is something more precious than money in Baghdad, the two princes, the caliph's women, and their treasure. The other coaches try to support Asuli, and then in the end, Radi snaps. How often you give me advice when I have not asked for it. Your servant is guilty, my lord, but only out of fear for you. I shall not say one more word. And the episode is sealed by a final conversation where Asuli complains to the chamberlain, you gestured for me to speak and see what you got me into. And the chamberlain replies that the subject should not be mentioned again. Indeed, the caliph continues for Mosul and only returns to Baghdad after accepting an unattractive deal with Ibn Hamdan. The deal had been much better before, and it was negotiated not with him, not with the caliph, but with the Amir al-Umara, on whom now Aradi is completely dependent financially, and so has no choice but to accept. And during all this time, the caliph remains cold with Asuli, overlooking him at receptions, in favor of the Munajim rivals. El Qasida, where Rasuli seeks to get back into the Caliph's graces, going as far as praising Bashkan the Amir, merely elicits a mild reaction. It's almost ignored. Eventually, however, on the eve of his return to the Caliph, to Baghdad, Al-Radi, the Caliph, summons Rasuli alone and sort of half acknowledges that he should not have gone to Mosul. So now we have the context of the stomachache incident. Yeah, this incident of the stomachache comes after this whole story of this whole trip to Mosul, which was disastrous for the Caliph, and which Osti knows very well and tells us very well why it was disastrous, and why the Caliph shouldn't have done it, and what the financial and also political repercussions were. So let's go back to Masoudi for a moment. Masoudi talks about, So Masoudi talks about Al-Radi's successor. With Al-Radi's successor, the Al-Muttaqi, the situation becomes even worse, because Al-Muttaqi has to chase out of Baghdad. He cannot stay in Baghdad because it is not safe for him. So not only can he not protect the population, but he is not safe himself in Baghdad. And this is what Osti says. I mean, Osti is really not happy at all about Al-Muttaqi, because Al-Muttaqi didn't want court companions, so he effectively ended his job at court. But he also is against. He says he had really bad advice, and he shouldn't have done. He shouldn't have left Baghdad. He says, first of all, he says it is unheard of for a caliph to say, I do not want table companions, as I shall be in the company of the Quran, thinking that having the Quran as companion would be a trait peculiar to him, not shared by his predecessors, thinking that he was one of a kind, or that that idea was incomprehensible to them, and he was the only one who had grasped its value. So he's saying, well, it's not that because you have table companions, you don't read the Quran. You can do both. You're just being pretentious. And the mistake he makes is also tied to the fact that he has nobody around him who can advise. And what he says is his first senseless, reckless mistake was leaving the seat of his rule and going out when there was no reason compelling him to do that. That's the end of all the stories I wanted to tell you about Osti. Just to go back to the, we started with sort of a ranking of catastrophes, ranking of disasters. And I think the Al-Masoudi and Osti have this idea in common of the centrality of Baghdad, of the importance for the Caliph to be in Baghdad and be the point of reference for the Caliphate, and also the importance of the Caliph for the inhabitants of Baghdad. Osti and also Al-Masoudi spend a lot of time talking about the conditions of the people in Baghdad, who really looked after the interests of the people, and this is the, really the duty of the Caliph. And neglecting this duty will have grave consequences. Osti is accused of not having historical sense, not being a real historian, too petty, too concentrated on small things. I would say something slightly different. I would say the opposite. I would say that he's he has a lot of historical sense, but that his historical sense is concentrated on Baghdad and on the prosperity of the institution of the Caliphate, whereas the rest of historians lose interest in Baghdad from this point onwards, lose this interest in the caliphate, their interest in the Umara, in the Seljuks, in what happens in Egypt, in what happens in other parts of the Islamic world. There is nobody better, I think, who understands Baghdad and the Caliph and his people as a Sunni. Thank you very much.